54.
We have totally around 15 in YouTube. So yeah. I think for the benefit of people who are prompt, we could begin on time, Bijal.
Yes, sir. Okay, I'll just start.
Okay.
Good evening to one and all. On behalf of Indian Psychiatric Society, Karnataka Chapter, and Team Teliarogya, I would like to welcome today's speaker, Dr. Ravichandra Karkala, the associate professor from Bangalore. And I would like to welcome the Dr. Sripathi Ambert, the psychiatrist from Mitra Hospital, Manipal, and also our president of the Indian Psychiatric Society, Karnataka chapter. And I welcome the Teliarogya team coordinator, head Dr. Mahesh Gowda, director, Spandana Hospital, Rajaji Nagar, Bangalore. And I welcome the moderator of this series, Dr. Narayan Mutalik, as well as Dr. Harish Kulkarni from SNMC Bagalkot. And I welcome all the participants. Dear friends, the Indian Psychiatric Society, as you are all aware, and the team Teliarogya is quite innovative in its action, especially with respect to the academic as well as the other activities concerned. So Indian Psychiatric Society, because of this innovative things, has won 8 times the Best Branch Award from the National IPS. National IPS. So in earlier, in the last few weeks, you all enjoyed the series on psychopharmacology, which was done excellently by our member and executive committee member, Dr. Mohan Sunil Kumar, and which was again coordinated by our team Teliarogya. And not only the postgraduates, the many practicing psychiatrists also, including faculties, have learned a lot from that series. And the second of that series, another thing with respect to the psychopathology series, we are starting this series, which comprises around 9 topics. The eminent speakers from the different medical colleges, medical institutes of the Karnataka, as well as out of Karnataka, will be participating as the faculties, and which will be chaired by the senior most members of our society, who have, you can see the changes, that is youngsters speaking in the psychopathology, the experienced, the senior psychiatrist and faculties will be chairing the session. So the psychopathology, what the youngsters have understood and what it was understood by the senior people, senior faculties, because earlier days, the psychopathology was given a lot of importance. But nowadays, we are losing that essence of psychopathology in recent teachings. So with the aim of having the same essence once again, this is a series the Indian Psychiatric Society and Team Teliarogya has planned. And I hope this series, which comprises 9 series, will have a good academic fit to the most of the postgraduates of psychiatry, as well as the practicing psychiatrists. Another interesting thing I would like to announce now only, that is, in the future, as before this series completes, we would like to start, we'll be starting another series on neurology, including EEG, for the benefit of the postgraduates as well as the practicing psychiatrist, which will be dealt by one of the eminent neurologists from Karnataka, and who is also faculty of neurology in well-reputed medical institutes. So this series, I hope it will be very good. And I would like to welcome the technical team person from the ICON Laboratories, Mr. Sriram, for this series. And now I would like to introduce Dr. Narayan Mutalik, who is the professor of psychiatry from SN Medical College, Bagalkot, who will be moderating this series, along with his colleague, Dr. Harish Kulkarni, who is the assistant professor of psychiatry in SN Medical College, Bagalkot. Now, I would like to request the moderator of this series, Dr. Narayan Mutalik and Dr. Harish Kulkarni, to take over. Thank you on behalf of IPSKC and Team Teliarogya. Over to Narayan.
Thank you very much, Vijay sir. So As Dr. Bijal said, it is a new Tediaroga team in collaboration with the Indian Psychiatric Society Karnataka chapter. So without wasting much time, we will start the topic. Before that, I would like to introduce our chairperson, Dr. Sripati M. Bhatt. Sir is a well-known figure. He has completed his DPM and MD from NIMHANS Bangalore, and he has also completed DNB. And he has been a professor in the Department of Psychiatry, Kasturba Medical College, Manipal. And currently he has retired, and he has been a PG teacher since last around 40 years. Tremendous experience in psychiatry, and currently he is a private practitioner. And also, he is a current president of Indian Psychiatric Society, Karnataka chapter. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you.
So, I would like to request Dr. Sripati M. Bhatt, sir, to introduce our speaker of today's topic, Dr. Ravichandra Karkala. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Narayan. Good evening to everyone who are watching this program. And I am sure today, the topic on psychopathology, thought disorders, form and content, right?
Form and stream, sir.
Form and stream of thought, the disorders of form and stream of thought. And it is good that such a topic has been taken up for discussion today, because as Dr. Pichal was mentioning, many times people think that what is given as criteria in the DSM are enough to make a diagnosis. Maybe it is, but to confirm whether whatever phenomena that you have elicited is the right one and it meets all the criteria for the psychopathology that you have elicited. So that is very important, and it is very interesting also. And those who are interested in studying psychopathology of the person, individual person, I think this is going to be much use, all the details that you gather. And today we have Dr. Ravichandra Karkala to enlighten us on this topic. I welcome Dr. Ravichandra. He is a young psychiatrist. He is an associate professor at Yenapoya Medical College, Mangalore. He did his MBBS from MMC, that is Mysore Medical College, and then his MD is from CIP Ranchi, Central Institute of Psychiatry, Ranchi. And then onwards, he has been in Mangalore with Dr. Yenapoya College, and I'm sure he is a favorite teacher of his students. He has interest in the area of child and adolescent psychiatry, psychopathology, psychotherapy, and also he is very much involved in awareness programs to the community. And he was actively involved during this COVID times with whatever that we had to do with community. He was very active on webinars and all media. In addition to being associate professor in psychiatry, he also represents the Yenapoya Medical College faculty development program and few more. He has many papers to his credit in the national and international journals. And we have the right person here to tell us what is meant by each one of these terms, that is disorder of form and disorder of stream of thought. So I am sure all of us will be benefited, more so the PGs. I request Dr. Ravichandra to take over. Ravichandra, please.
Thank you very much, sir. I'll just share my screen. Good evening to everyone who has joined. It is a wonderful privilege for me to be presenting this session on psychopathology the first of the series. And I feel blessed that Dr. Shripati Bhatt, who is the president of Indian Psychiatric Society Karnataka chapter, is chairing this session. So I feel really proud about this fact. So I am going to be talking on disorders of thought. And in this first session, I am going to focus on stream and form disorders, you know, of thought. Imagine this scenario in OPD, right? So imagine you are a resident sitting in the OPD and you have cases coming through. So you see this man, okay? He's a middle-aged man. So the moment you have a look at him, he has a very sad expression on his face. So you just ask this man, you know, how is your mood? And he says that I am feeling sad, doctor. So then you fire away one or two other questions. Do you feel fatigued? Do you enjoy things like before these days? And, you know, you just look at the nosological systems that we have, DSM-5 or ICD-10. You just check some boxes in the checklist, you know, basically the diagnostic criteria that we have in the nosological systems. And then we come to the diagnosis. So many times what happens is, you know, this becomes a sort of routine in our day-to-day clinical assessments. And we may lose the art and, you know, the beauty that is there in understanding the psychopathology of that particular person, or, you know, what we call as descriptive psychopathology, where we look into the subjective experience of the individual as well as look and observe for signs and symptoms, which can, you know, give us a lot more inputs than just a diagnosis. It can help us, you know, in managing this patient better. Maybe, you know, just that interview focusing on the psychopathology of this individual may have therapeutic impact in itself. So that's why psychopathology is so important. You know, some of you may have read this article. It had appeared in Schizophrenia Bulletin in 2007, written by Nancy Andreasen, DSM and the Death of Phenomenology. So Nancy Andreasen very sarcastically comments in this article, since the publication of DSM-3 in 1980, there has been a steady decline in the teaching of careful clinical evaluation that is targeted to the individual person's problems and social context, and that is enriched by a good general knowledge of psychopathology. Students are taught to memorize DSM rather than learn the complexities from the great psychopathologists of the past. So this is, you know, this article is an eye-opener for all of us. And, you know, Nancy Andreasen had written this in 2007 itself. And things, of course, have not been any better in 2021. So we can, you know, if we neglect phenomenology and psychopathology, it would be only for our detriment. It will only lead to a deterioration in the satisfaction of care that we can give to our patients. So today's topic would be on thought disorders. And, you know, the unique uniqueness of humans is, of course, our ability to think. And we think in images and ideas. We, you know, we frequently keep comparing whatever is happening around us to whatever memories we have accumulated over a period of many years. We tend to reason. We tend to, you know, dream and fantasize when we think. We use deductive reasoning. We use inductive reasoning. We use complex tasks such as, you know, problem solving and other cognitive processes, which all entails the process of thinking. So thinking is a very special and unique quality of humans. And definitely when somebody has an ailment which affects the thinking, it leads to devastating consequences for that particular individual. So, you know, when we talk about some conceptual issues surrounding the disorders of thought, speech and language, thought is always manifested in speech. Like, of course, we can ask our patients about their subjective experience of thinking. Like, for example, a patient who is in hypomania may tell that he is experiencing racing thoughts, right? So we can definitely assess the subjective experience of the individual, but most of our assessment of the thought processes is through the speech that is produced by that particular individual. So the cognitive processes behind this thought process is of particular interest to cognitive neuroscientists, you know, who apply various neuropsychological batteries or use various techniques to understand the cognitive processes behind the thinking ability of an individual. But us, when we sit in our clinics, when we are managing patients, we are mostly interested in clinical psychopathology. That is the thought processes that manifest as speech, right? Speech and language. That's why the title Disorders of Thought is a little incomplete, and I feel it's a little obsolete. And Nancy Anderson, way back in 1986, you know, emphasized that we should, you know, move away from this terminology, that thought disorders, and include speech and language also, right? So, when we assess the speech of a particular individual, of course, we are getting insights into the thought processes of that particular individual. So, let's begin with Nancy Anderson herself. So basically, her contributions to the field of thought disorders is extremely important, because she was one of the first persons who challenged the nosological systems move away from Bleulerian symptoms. You all know that Eugen Bleuler mentioned about the four A's, that is blunted affect, loosening of association, autism, and ambivalence. So loosening of association, which predominated the minds and the intellects of all the psychiatrists of yesteryears, mostly till the 80s, till the 1960s or up to 1980s, many psychiatrists were of the thought that loosening of association is pathognomonic of schizophrenia. So, and other thing is, when the DSM-3 was introduced, because Bleulerian symptoms, that is these symptoms of autism and blunted affect and the loosening of association, because they were not very objective, or because they were considered to be imprecise, and started focusing on delusions and hallucinations mostly in the diagnostic systems. So delusions and hallucinations somehow predominated the diagnostic criteria in all our nosological systems, be it DSM or ICD. So Nancy Anderson was one of the first person who challenged this move away from Bleulerian symptoms. Why? Because she felt with her experience, with her decades of experience of working with patients of schizophrenia, she felt that delusions and hallucinations are not the only symptoms of schizophrenia. We very, very well know that there are many other aspects, many other facets to the disorder of schizophrenia. And she felt that positive symptoms like delusions and hallucinations may be predominant in the acute phase, but once the acute symptoms are over, in the chronic phase, there are these Bleulerian symptoms which are much more crippling than the positive symptoms which we see in the acute phase. So she started, emphasizing the need to assess Bleulerian symptoms, especially loosening of association or the disorders in thought, in a very systematic fashion. So people started thinking that thought disorder is not synonymous with schizophrenia after her contributions. With her research and with her studies done in the 1980s, she showed that loosening of association and various other problems in thought and disorders of thought can be seen in various disorders, not only schizophrenia. And other thing that she highlighted is thought disorder is not just a unitary concept. She told that when we assess thought disorders, we should also look at disorders of communication and also disorders of language. So she included these three aspects, that is thought, language, and communication, in her research. And you all know that she has devised a tool which is the scale for assessment of thought, language, and communication in the 1980s. So she suggested that thought disorder is not a unitary concept. It includes many other aspects. And she emphasized the importance of communication and language disorders in patients with various psychiatric disorders, even patients with mood disorders and psychotic disorders like schizophrenia. And only when we assess all these aspects, we will be doing justice to the assessment of thought disorders in our patients. Now, today's session will be mostly focused on disorders of thought and not mostly on disorders of speech and language. This categorization is only because, emphasizing this categorization because, our textbooks like Sims Symptoms of Psychopathology or Fish Psychopathology, they demarcate disorders of thought and disorders of speech and language. I will not be covering disorders of speech and language today. I will not be focusing more on aphasias, and I'll be only focusing on disorders of thought today. Now, when we see a patient practically, right, how do we start, looking for the problems in thought? Of course, it is with a conversation. So when we start having the conversation, for example, if you listen to a jugalbandi between two expert musicians, you can see the spontaneity with which they exchange those musical notes. There is a fluency to it. They take turns while doing the jugalbandi or the duel, and they also share a mutual topic, the ragas and the tunes, the rhythms that they are playing on the various instruments or they are singing. They share a mutual topic, and the one person who is playing the music, the other person comprehends the music that is being played by the other, and that's why he is able to respond with his jugalbandi. And also the other person is able to make sense of his partner, whatever he is playing or whatever he is singing. And of course, when they are playing those instruments, there are many other associated behaviors. They are enjoying the music with their facial expression. If you have seen a concert, musical concert, you may have seen, if you have seen a live musical concert, you would see the changes in facial expression that happens between the musicians, how they exchange with their, maybe by making eye contact or making their, by making some gestures or making some sounds or intonations like wah wah. So, a jugalbandi is a very, very, simple metaphor or analogy with which you can understand the beauty of a conversation. So when we are having a conversation with a patient, we should definitely look for these aspects in the conversation, right? So, for example, if the jugalbandi was between two people who don't know music well, or if they are just beginners, a person interested in music will definitely find out that, these people are not really good in whatever they are doing. In the same way, when somebody is conversing with us, we as human beings, we innately and naturally understand that something is going wrong in our conversation, right? So you need not be a psychologist or a psychiatrist or a mental health professional to understand this. Every human being has this innate capacity to understand whether the conversation is going well, smoothly, or whether the other person is enjoying this, right? So any typical normal human being, a healthy human being, would be able to understand so many aspects of a conversation. Of course, he would be able to identify when the conversation is not going well. But we as psychiatrists should look at certain aspects of the conversation which can help us to delineate certain disorders of thought. One is, of course, spontaneity, as I already told, then fluency, then turn-taking. Turn-taking means, for example, a patient with mania will not respect turn-taking. So when you ask him a question, he will answer to that question, and then he would just go on, talking a lot about some other ideas that he is getting. He would not have the decency to give you your turn to speak. So turn-taking is something which you can look for. And also mutual topic. If you are asking about his childhood, a patient with schizophrenia who is totally preoccupied with paranoid thoughts may just wander away from his childhood experience and start talking about his conspirators who are you know, planning something sinister to end his life. So they, a person may not share a mutual topic and may divert away from the themes or topics of conversation that you are trying to engage the person in. Other thing is comprehension. Unless you understand, unless a patient understands what you are asking him or what questions you are asking him or what you want to want him, what you want him to talk about, then definitely the conversation cannot be smooth. Also, patient should make sense of whatever you are asking, and you should be able to make sense of what the patient is telling you. And of course, there are so many other associated behaviors that happen in a conversation, you know, behaviors such as facial expressions, gestures, you know, modulation in the tone of our voice, right? And, you know, maybe even some autonomic signs. For example, if somebody is becoming anxious, he may have a blushed face, or he may start sweating, you know, he may start becoming too fidgety, you know, when he's talking with you. So there are so many aspects of behaviors other than what the patient is talking with you that can tell a lot about what is happening in his thought process or what is happening in his mind, right? So understanding the aspects or the you know, characteristics of conversation is extremely important at the beginning of this discussion. And then we talk about model of associations, which was given by Jaspers. Jaspers, you know, this the source of this you know, diagram, symptoms in the mind. So what this model of association tells is there is you know, you get a thought, and that thought leads to certain set of other possible thoughts, okay? And you know, all these possible thoughts have some association with the preceding thought, the original thought, and the associations and the thoughts that arise are called as constellation, okay? And depending on what in your mind or what is what Jaspers called as determining tendency, choose one among the possible thoughts, which will be the actual thought in the set of those possible thoughts. And the thought stream of thought will then progress from the actual thought, you know, in the second stage to another set of possible thoughts. And then again, it will, you know, you will choose one of those possible thoughts depending on what goal you have in mind or what determining tendency is dictating the thought process, basically. Right. So let's look at the example given in Sims again. You know, you are sitting in a room, a patient is sitting in a room, you know, he thinks as he sits in a room. So he gets these possible thoughts. That is, he must talk to a certain person. I feel cold. The chair I'm sitting is uncomfortable. I'm in an uncomfortable chair, and I have to sort out my accounts, bank accounts. So because because he is feeling cold at that particular instance, you know, because of the determining tendency, he starts thinking, you know, he starts there is a generation of possible thoughts based on the thought I feel cold. That is, either there is a drought or perhaps I'm developing a flu, you know, which is quite possible if he's sitting in his room during lockdown, during the coronavirus pandemic, and put on, I must put on a pullover, you know, I'm feeling cold, I have to put on a pullover, or I can hear a drip in the roof, you know, because in the environment, he is able to hear dripping from the roof. It suddenly comes to mind to him that the roof is leaking. So that's why the determining tendency then will lead him to think about how he can fix the drip in the roof. And that's why he gets a ladder and takes a bucket. He makes sure that the drip in the roof is fixed, right? So as you can see, one thought leads to a set of possible thoughts, and that again leads to, choosing of one particular thought based on what goal you have in mind or what determines the thought process, sequence of thought process. And therefore, the thought flows ahead. So this is something known as model of associations, which we can keep in mind to understand the disorders of thought. Then, there is something known as types of thinking. Okay,
many people, you know, Fish has called it as functions of thinking or the process of thinking. That is, whenever we think in these three ways. Either it can be fantasy thinking. For example, fantasy thinking is also called as undirected thinking or deristic thinking, right? Where, you know, you just let loose your mind and fantasize whatever, you know, comes to your mind. For example, you know, if you are disappointed with whatever happened in your day, you may just have a daydream of you being, you know, celebrity cricketer, okay? Or, you know, I had a patient who was a big fan of Salman Khan all her childhood. And, you know, she had a dream of going to the Bollywood and become an actress. But somehow her dream was thwarted because she was married off at a very young age. And what happened is, unfortunately, her husband was abusive towards her and he started beating her. He started, you know, treating her in a very bad way. So she started fantasizing about Salman Khan, and slowly over a period of time, she started believing that she is a participant in Big Boss. And there are cameras all around her home, which others cannot see. And Salman Khan is monitoring each and every move of hers. And Salman Khan will come someday and take her to Bollywood, you know, because her reality after marriage was so painful. And, you know, it was so overwhelming. Reality was so overwhelming. She went into excessive fantasy, you know, what Bleuler called as excessive autism, right? She went into this kind of an autistic and fantastic thinking, and it slowly, from overvalued ideas, it became so severe that it became delusional. And she started becoming violent towards her husband, started telling her husband that I want to go to Bollywood, Salman Khan may come any day to take me. So that is about fantasy thinking, how it can range from a person who is normal to a person who is having a mood disorder or a non-affective psychosis like schizophrenia. Then comes imaginative thinking. Imaginative thinking, when we talk about imaginative thinking, of course, three things have to be kept in mind. One is we have the capacity for imagery. That is, sitting here in Mangalore, I can imagine as if I am in front of the Taj Mahal, right? So, you know, in my mind's eye, I can create imagery of the beautiful Taj Mahal. Also, we have the capacity to do counterfactual thinking. What is counterfactual thinking? That is thinking, you know, which is opposite to facts. Basically, I'm sitting here in Mangalore, but I think that I am in Delhi right now. I am in Agra right now in front of the Taj Mahal, right? So that is counterfactual thinking, right? And also, there may be a lot of symbolism involved, right? Because Valentine's Day was very close. So Taj Mahal comes to my mind when I am imagining and, you know, sitting and imagining something, right? So this is something, you know, me going to Agra and sitting in front of the Taj Mahal is very much possible. So imaginative thinking is, you know, very much possible in the realm of possibilities, right? And, you know, which is unlike fantasy thinking, where fantasy thinking is almost impossible or, you know, it's too fantastic to happen in reality. And the third process of thinking or function of thinking is something known as rational thinking. Rational thinking is, you know, what makes us, human and what makes us at the top of the animal species. So we use various mechanisms such as analogic reasoning, inductive reasoning, deductive reasoning, you know, we use problem solving, you know, all the cognitive processes that happen in the neurocircuitry in our brains lead to rational thinking. And rational thinking is something which we require for our jobs. We require for leading a, you know, productive and efficient life. So these are the various types of thinking which were described by Frank Fish. And it's important to understand, you know, in the beginning to understand disorders of thought. So coming to the disorders of thought per se, we usually categorize it into four sort of disorders. One is disorders of stream or progress of thought, disorders of form or organization, disorders of possession or volition, disorders of content or belief. In this session, I'll be focusing on the first two aspects. Coming to disorders of stream. So as I already told, when we talk about stream of thought, we usually imagine our thinking like a is like a stream, or it's like a flowing river, right? So when you think of a flowing river, so if it is summer and there is not much water in the river, you know, it may be flowing very slowly. But if there is a break of glacier, as happened recently, you know, the river may be flooded and the flow of water may be very fast. So these aspects, that is the speed with which the progression of thought or the stream of thought progresses, is something called as the thought tempo. So, if we want to categorize disorders of stream, then we should look at disorders of thought tempo. And the second one is disorders of continuity of thinking. That is there any break in the progress of thinking, or is there any gap? Is there any deviation in the progression of thinking? That is disorders of continuity of thinking. So let's look at thought tempo first. So the first abnormality that comes to mind, in thought tempo is, of course, flight of ideas, which is characteristically described in mania, but it can happen in many other disorders. It can even happen in excited schizophrenia. It can even happen in mixed affective states, where you may not see the rapidity with which the thought progresses, which is characteristic of mania, but still you may have flight of ideas. So as the name itself suggests, flight of ideas, you characteristically see that the person is jumping from one topic to the other, right? So there is no general direction of thinking. As you can see here very clearly in the diagrammatic representation, which is taken from Sims, that the person, jumps from one topic to the other. There is no determining tendency. There is no direction or goal of thought which is there, right? And there are there are no solid associations between the various topics or the sequential ideas in flight of ideas. So the associations are more like chance associations, right? For example, you are talking with a patient with, who has been diagnosed with mania, who has a manic disorder, and, the nurse is keeping a rose in her hairs. So the patient with mania, when he's talking about something, he looks at the rose and he starts talking about the rose is red and rose is symbolic of love and how he loved a girl in his childhood. So the progression of thought or the associations are very, very, meager, or they are not very strong, and they are mostly chance associations. And there can be clanging associations. Clanging associations, what do they mean is, basically, rather than a conceptual association between two pieces of thought, there is only association in terms of the sound or the way the ideas or the words or the phrases sound. For example, clanging associations can be alliteration. Alliteration is, for example, the softness of silence. As you can see, softness of silence. Here, the initial consonants are repeated in the neighboring words or phrases. Softness of silence, okay? Or there can be assonance where, progression of certain words or ideas based only on the sounds which is created by the vowels, which are there in the words, right? And there can be, usage of proverbs in between the speech. There can be usage of cliches, right? For example, the patient is talking about the rose, as I was explaining in the previous example. So he looks at the rose in the nurse's head and start telling that roses are red and is a symbol of love. And he starts talking, love is blind. Love is blind is a cliche, right? So, such associations can be seen, which are only by chance. So that is what we see in flight of ideas. And when flight of ideas is present in mania, there is pressure of speech. What is pressure of speech? The other person does not let you speak, okay? Or as I told in the beginning, the other person does not respect, turn-taking. He will not let you speak. He will not let you take your turn in the conversation. And he just goes on talking whenever he gets the chance, okay? And it's very difficult to stop the conversation. He is unable to, stop himself. There is this urge to go on speaking about certain set of things, right? So Nancy Anderson in her scale even tells that if the rate of words is more than 150 words per minute, then you can say that there is, you know, there is a good possibility that it is flight of ideas with rapid acceleration of speech, as well as you may see pressure of speech in that particular instance. Then there is this opposite of flight of ideas, which is retardation or inhibition or slow thinking. You know, slow thinking can be characteristically seen in moderate to severe depression with psychomotor retardation, where the individual, when you try to, you know, make him converse, the person is not able to get enough ideas, or there is a long latency in the responses that he is giving, or he may tell that I am unable to think anything, right? So there is production of very few ideas. Here you can very clearly see in flight of ideas, there were so many associated thoughts which were arising in the mind, whereas in retardation or inhibition, there are hardly any thoughts, okay? That's why the progression is very slow, right? And when you know, you are talking with this kind of a patient, you start feeling annoyed because you are not able to get any responses from him. You are made to wait a long time, you know, to get some response from him, and it can become very tedious and complicated for you. You may start losing your patience, right? So you need to be very patient. You need to give a lot of time in a patient who has retardation or inhibition. This can be characteristically seen in depression, but retardation or inhibition can be seen in manic stupor also. Why I am highlighting these things is, you know, there is a sort of tendency to equate flight of ideas with mania and retardation with depression. That is not true. These disorders in thought can be seen in a variety of psychiatric illnesses. Then there is circumstantial speech. As you can see, a normal speech should progress from the start to the point that the person wants to make. It is very direct. Whereas in circumstantial speech, the individual takes a very circuitous route, like the spiral which is displayed here. And when he is taking that circuitous route, he will go into unnecessary trivial details, right? For example, you ask him, you know, how was, you know, your mood yesterday? He starts telling, yesterday I got up at 7 o'clock. I slowly got up from the bed. I was not, you know, feeling very energetic. I made my tea afterwards. And after drinking tea, I was so tired, even after, you know, drinking that refreshing tea. And ultimately, the person slowly, by taking that circuitous route, reaches the point. Whereas in flight of ideas, you know, you would expect that the person will not reach their goal or point, you know, where they want to reach. Whereas in circumstantiality, slowly over a long period of time, after, you know, boring you a lot, the person may reach to that point. Okay. Some, you know, students who are just beginning their careers may get confused with circumstantial speech and prolixity, which is something known as ordered flight of ideas. In ordered flight of ideas, the chance associations are very less, rapidity of speech is very less, clanging associations and other associations are very less. And as the name itself suggests, the flight of ideas is a little ordered so that the person reaches the goal, right? And unlike circumstantial speech, there is a lively embellishment to the prolixity, right? So prolixity can be seen in a patient with hypomania. The individual with that particular individual with hypomania may also tell you that I am having racing thoughts, which can give you a clue that this person may have ordered flight of ideas. Then we come to this other set of you know, disorders, in disorders of stream, that is disorders of continuity or flow of thinking. You know, you can see something called as tangential speech. So instead of reaching the point from the beginning, the patient takes a tangent. That is, he completely misses the point which he wants to make, right? So, you know, tangential speech can be observed like that. Another, you know, another abnormality that you can see in flow of thinking is perseveration. Perseveration is a very characteristic symptom of organic disorders, especially, you know, disorders which are causing abnormality in the frontal lobe, you know, especially the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex or the DLPFC, which leads to executive dysfunction, right? So when we look at disorders of thought, there is a contradicting view. Some people say that disorders of thought are due to executive dysfunction and cognitive dysfunction. There are another set of people who tell that it is due to dysfunction in the language areas in your brain. That is, it is very close to aphasias. But as we can see, these set of disorders of thought, you can see some disorders like perseveration, which is mostly due to cognitive dysfunction or executive dysfunction. And then there are some other set of disorders which are very close, which resemble aphasias. So what is perseveration? Perseveration is repetition of a certain idea, repetition of a certain word, which has lost its relevance. For example, if you ask a patient, who is the prime minister of India? So, the individual tells that, it's Narendra Modi. And you ask another question or you try to start a discussion about some other topic. The individual keeps telling, Narendra Modi, or keeps repeating the phrase Narendra Modi in between the speech output. A person need not be a bhakt, but still he can go on repeating if he has perseveration, if he has some executive dysfunction. As it is depicted in this diagram, in the first set of ideas, that particular response may be relevant, that particular thought may be relevant. Then as the thought progresses, there is repetition of that particular idea or that particular phrase or word, even after it has lost its relevance. That is, in the next instances, it is irrelevant. We also have to differentiate perseveration from stereotypy, because stereotypy, the verbal stereotypy or ideational stereotypy, is basically a disorder of volition, right? It's a disorder of will, where an individual goes on repeating a certain word or a certain set of phrases, despite of whatever, may be the conversation. For example, an individual with chronic schizophrenia may come to you and repeatedly ask, what is the time, right? And, you look at your watch and try to tell the time to that patient. He may just have moved away from you because he's not interested in asking you time. Basically, he's repeating these phrases, what is the time, because of lack of volition and because of the disorder of volition, there is stereotyping, right? So that is something known as perseveration. Another, abnormality in the flow of thinking can be snapping or blocking of thought. Blocking of thought is where there is a sudden disruption in the progression of thought. It is something like pulling a plug from a machine, right? Suddenly the individual experiences there is a gap or there is a blank, is totally devoid of thoughts. And you can differentiate this from absence seizures, because absence seizures can also appear or present with speech arrest. A person with absence seizures will not be able to recall that experience of not having any thought, whereas an individual with thought block or snapping, as you can see in schizophrenia, the individual will be able to express you this subjective experience of not having any thought for a certain duration of time. Also, he can give a persecutory explanation. He may tell that somebody stole my thoughts. Somebody is, extracting my thoughts using satellite, and using x-rays, right? He may give a certain delusional explanation to the experience that he is having. So that is something known as thought blocking or snapping. Then we move on to disorders of form. So, when we talk about disorders of form, basically these are disorders in conceptual thinking or disorders in abstract thinking or disorders in the organization of thinking, right? And the usual term that we ordinarily use in our clinical practice is something known as formal thought disorder, right? But as I already was alluding to in my previous examples, Nancy Anderson pointed out that this formal thought disorder, we should move away from this term formal thought disorder, and we should talk about disorders of thought, language, and communication, because she emphasize that there are abnormalities in language as well as communication, and it is not just abnormalities in thought. So looking at some historical perspectives, and when you look at the historical perspectives of disorders of thought, most of it is focused on disorders of thought in schizophrenia. Kriplin used the term akataphasia, and what he meant with the term akataphasia is the expression of disorders of thought in the speech of a particular individual. Bleuler, as I already talked about, suggested loosening of associations as one of the primary symptoms of schizophrenia. Gardner suggested that formal thought disorder or thought disorders, of form are basically regression. It's a form of regression. Cameron suggested there is asyndesis. Okay. Asyndesis means, as the name itself suggests, asyndesis. There is no connection between, sequential ideas. There is a very loose connection. There is no strong connection between sequential ideas. Cameron also suggested something known as over-inclusive thinking. That is, instead of focusing on a particular goal, the person includes a lot of other ideas, right? Instead of talking about form of thought right now, I start including disorders of consciousness or disorders of experience, which is not related to my topic today, but it may be related to psychopathology. There is a loose association, but there is no strong link between the two set of thoughts. So that is over-inclusive thinking, right? Goldstein suggested that in schizophrenia, you can see something known as concrete thinking, right? So there is defect in abstraction, and that's why thinking is very concrete, right? For example, one of my patients was telling that, chaat masala, I ate a lot of chaat masala as a young person. That's why, I have a lot of problems in my stomach. So I asked him, why chaat masala caused you, problems in your stomach? He told that chaat masala, chaat means in Hindi, chaatna means licking, right? So that masala, when it is prepared, dogs may have licked that masala. That's why when I ate chaat masala, it led to problems in my stomach. So you can see the concrete level of thinking in this particular patient. Von Domeres, he suggested that there is defect in the deductive reasoning or logical thinking in individuals that leads to the manifestation of thought disorders in schizophrenia. And Schneider, I will discuss about this in detail. He talked about derailment, substitution, omission, fusion, and driveling. We will look into all these aspects in the subsequent slides. Schneider, when he talked about all the problems in thoughts, in the thought process, he was of the belief that healthy thinking has three, peculiar characteristics or typical characteristics. They are constancy. That is when, we start speaking, there is a clear constant flow to the thought process. There is a constancy of theme, or there is a constancy of direction, what Jaspers talked about, determining tendency. He also talked that there is an organization to the thought, and there is continuity in the thought process, right? So when there are abnormalities in these three aspects, various forms of thought disorders appear. So in this diagram, Schneider mostly talked about transitory thinking, driveling thinking, and desultory thinking. What is transitory thinking? Transitory thinking can arise, as the name itself suggests, transitory. That is, the flow is not constant. It is transient, right? And that can be due to derailment. What is derailment? The thought process, instead of moving in this direction, which is the expected direction, when you're talking with the patient, you expect that the thought will move in this direction, but actually it moves on to a subsidiary set of thoughts, right? So the patient takes a complete deviation. That is, he slips into a subsidiary set of thought. You can think of the thought process like a railway track. The train takes a completely different track. Okay, it takes a moves on to or slips on to a subsidiary thought, which may not be directly or strongly associated with the original thought. What is omission? Omission is there is a particular idea or thought is omitted in a set of thoughts. So there is a gap in the flow or constancy, right? And then there is substitution, where there is a normal flow of thought, but there are certain set of ideas which are substituted instead of a particular set of ideas which you normally expect there, right? So instead of some particular idea, there is substitution of set of ideas. So when you have derailment, omission, or substitution, the individual will show or manifest transitory thinking. what is driveling thinking? Imagine what what Schneider talked about is, in driveling thinking, there the individual has a certain set of ideas, and also he has a particular outline of those ideas, but there is no good organization of these particular ideas. For example, the first the schematic diagram is of normal thinking. So imagine I have depicted ideas with three colors, blue, green, red, and green. So the thought process moves like this: blue, red, and green, blue one, red one, and green one, right? So these are components, these are component ideas, and you expect that this kind of organization will be there in the normal person. Whereas a patient with schizophrenia, although he has these various ideas, the organization is abnormal. That is, there is R1, B, R, G1, B1, G, right? So this is a easy way to schematically depict how you can explain driveling thinking, right? So the individual has all the ideas. He has an outline of what he has to speak, but he is unable to organize his ideas when he speaks, right? And desultory thinking is where a particular idea forces into a set of ideas, and that leads to a small discontinuity in the thinking process, right? So these three types of thinking were highlighted by Schneider. What is the pragmatic or the current approach is basically what was given by Nancy Andreasen in her scales, SANS and SAPS. So she talks about negative FTD, where, under the heading Alogia in SANS, if you look up a SANS scale, you would find, aspects such as poverty of speech, poverty of content of speech, then blocking and increased latency. I have addressed these things already. And then there can be positive formal thought disorder, where you can see derailment, you can see tangentiality, you can see incoherence, you can see illogicality, where there is lack of deductive reasoning or reasoning. There can be circumstantiality, there can be pressure of speech, there can be distractible speech, there can be clanging in speech. So Nancy Andreasen talked about negative formal thought disorder, where, as in negative symptoms of schizophrenia, there is something normal that you expect which is missing. Whereas in positive formal thought disorder, you don't expect a certain thing to happen in the thought process, but it is happening in that particular patient. So she divided it into negative FTD and positive FTD. Negative FTD you can see under Alogia in SANS, and positive FTD you can see under the same heading, positive FTD or formal thought disorder, in symptom scale for assessment of positive symptoms or SAPS. So now coming to how do you assess clinically? Of course, you have to do a detailed psychiatric interview. Nancy Andreasen in her scale TLC talks about giving at least 50 minutes of time. So it's crucial that you give enough time. Also, if you are in between an examination, of course, you cannot spend 50 minutes in assessment of form of a disorder of thought. Then definitely it is very important that right from the point you start interviewing the patient, you start thinking about, does he have any abnormalities in thought? It's not when you get to thought, formal thought disorder section or form of thought section or content of thought section that you start thinking about these abnormalities. But what you can do is you can definitely give some neutral topic which may not be related to the content of psychopathology of that particular patient, which can bring about these errors or these disorders in thinking. Then there are definitely a lot of rating scales that you can use. Which are the rating scales that you can use? One is thought, language, and communication scale given by Nancy Andreasen. She introduced this scale to improve the reliability of assessment of formal thought disorder, or as she emphasized, thought, language, and communication. It has about 20 items. I encourage, especially postgraduates, to look up this scale. She has also given beautiful examples on what are these particular, abnormalities in thought. So it's a must read for all postgraduates. It's easily accessible, freely available on Google. Then there is something known as thought and language index, which was introduced by Liddell et al. In 2002. Which is basically a shorter version of TLC by Andreasen. In TLI, Thought and Language Index, they usually give a card of TAT or Rorschach-Inkblot test and ask the individual to give a thought sample or record, and you record that thought sample and try to analyze for abnormalities. And this is a shorter version because Andreasen scale TLC is very time consuming. So if you are running short on time, you can use Hot and Language Index, you know, instead of TLC. Also, very popular psychiatric rating scales that we use day in and day out, like Brief Psychiatric Rating Scale by Overall and Gorham, released, published in 1962, has one component called as conceptual disorganization, where you rate it from not present to extremely severe, where you look at thought processes, whether they are confused, disconnected, or disorganized. Also, PANASYS, Positive and Negative Syndrome Scale, you know, by K et al., has, you know, various components which can help you to assess thought disorders. Under positive scale, you know, there are 7 items, as you know. The second item is on conceptual disorganization. And if you look at the manual of PANASYS, they have beautifully described what are the, you know, when you rate them on the Likert scale from 1 to 7, what does each level of severity mean? That is beautiful. And, you know, unless you read this, you will not be able to understand how to objectively assess formal thought disorder in your patient. And also in negative scale, there are 3 components, 5, 6, and 7, that is difficulty in abstract thinking, lack of spontaneity and flow of conversation, and stereotype thinking, which focus on formal thought disorder. And of course, as I've already alluded to, SAPS and SANS by Nancy Anderson, that is, you know, positive form formal thought disorder in SAPS and Alogia in SANS focuses on these thought disorders. Also, you know, some researchers have used Rorschach-Inkblot test and thematic apperception test. In fact, there are various, features in the scoring systems, like the Exner scoring system in Rorschach-Inkblot test, where disorders of thought can be assessed, right? But using these tools are time consuming, which may not be possible for clinical usage. And then there are procedures such as CLOSE procedure for assessment of abnormalities of form of thought or abnormalities in language, which is mostly of theoretical interest. And you know, if you're interested, you should look up what is CLOSE procedure, modified CLOSE procedure, and reverse CLOSE procedure, which is given beautifully in SIMS. And these are mostly, you know, the basic principle in CLOSE procedure is that the speech of the speech sample of a particular, you know, of a typical normal individual is very predictable. If you remove certain words or phrases from a sentence or some or from a paragraph of a normal individual, another person will be able to easily predict those missing parts. Whereas the speech sample of a patient, it is unpredictable, and you will not be able to easily guess the missing words. In reverse CLOSE procedure, what you do is basically you ask a patient, you know, you take out certain words from a paragraph, and you ask the person, the patient with schizophrenia, to basically predict those words. And it is seen that patients with schizophrenia will not be able to do that very well, right? So these are some of the rating scales and tools which you can use to objectively assess, you know, these disorders in thought. But I cannot emphasize the value of, you know, empathy and, you know, developing that rapport with your patient, giving time for assessment of disorders of thought, which is crucial, right? You know, unless you are empathetic, unless you are sensitive to what the patient is speaking, unless you are able to establish a good rapport and give time, you will not be able to assess these disorders very well. And, you know, even if you use these objective scales or, you know, rating scales or tools, you may fail in this venture. So, you know, to conclude, I would say that subjective experience of thought, cognitive functions which are behind thought processes, needs more exploration in our day-to-day practice as well as in our research. Thought disorders, including formal thought disorder, is no more synonymous to schizophrenia. So our you know, tendency to think that thought disorder is just formal thought disorder, or thought disorder is only focused on schizophrenia, is, you know, becoming wrong as days progress, right? And formal assessment using rating scales increases reliability of assessment of disorders of thought. So with this, I would like to conclude this brief session on disorders of thought. I may have overshot time, so you know, I apologize to the moderators and the chairperson. So thank you so much again for this wonderful opportunity.
Wonderful presentation, sir. Thank you very much. Over to the chairperson, Dr. Sripati Bhatt, sir.
Thank you very much,
you very much, Dr. Arun. I think we had a very nice, very good session with a lot of information with regard to the differentiation that has to be made various adjectives that you use when describing thought disorder, both in stream and in the form. And I do see some overlap between these two at times. For example, there are few items in the stream and form also, there is an overlap, like a slight overlap, but you have put it in such a way that we are able to see where the overlap is and know where to classify a particular type of thought disorder. And as you clarified it in the beginning itself, which we also told in the introductory remarks, my request to our PGs is, please, please study the psychopathology in detail. Okay, don't just stick to one book, read it in several books, and also more so the journal articles, because there you get a comprehensive concept of the whole thing, and you will be able to get some cross references which can again add to your knowledge how a particular concept has evolved over a period of time. For example, Dr. Ravichandra mentioned about what was called once as a formal thought disorder. Now the terminology that Nancy Andreessen uses is different. Thought, communication, and
language.
So I think it makes sense, and it has a social as well as neurobiological connotations in it. For example, when you say language, you think of neurological aspects. Communication, it becomes a social and psychological aspect of it. So you will be able to know how the concept has evolved over a period of time, how the same terms have been used with different definitions, and how new terms have been discovered in the process. I think it would be very interesting to read these things, and I hope our young budding psychiatrists would be inspired by this presentation to take it up seriously, and it is every aspect of mental status that you need to look into. So thank you, Dr. Ravichandra. Thanks a lot for the information. Sir, now I leave it to moderators to go ahead with further discussion on the case, on sir, the presentation. Presentation. Yeah.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you very much, sir. There is actually one question from Siddhi. Differentiation in verbigeration and perseveration.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah, verbigeration, if I remember properly, I think, it's something like jargon aphasia, or, the speech is too muddled to make any sense of the speech, right? So that is verbigeration. Whereas, perseveration is, as I told you already, it's a disorder in the executive control of thinking, where an individual is not able to switch from one task to the other. He is not able to plan. There is a problem in the neuropsychological or the cognitive functions or executive functions, such as set shifting and task switching, right? For example, if I start talking about the weather today, right? And then you suddenly I should be able to switch from my earlier ideas or thoughts about weather in Mangalore to how my work was today in the medical college, right? So that ease with which we shift from there one topic to the other depends on the planning that happens in our head. The executive functioning should be very good. Whereas in perseveration, what will happen is, because of organic pathology, for example, frontotemporal dementia or any other dementias like an Alzheimer's dementia or injury to the frontal lobe or frontal lobe syndromes, in these conditions, what can happen is, because of the executive dysfunction, there is a difficulty in set switching, right? So the individual keeps repeating a certain word or phrase, or he keeps repeating a certain set of ideas even after they have lost their relevance. So that is the difference between verbigeration. Whereas in verbigeration, you know, you cannot, it's like a word salad, you know, you cannot make any sense out of whatever the patient is telling you, right? And, you know, jargon aphasia is something, you know, which is seen in Wernicke's aphasia. Probably, you know, when you have a session on disorders of speech and language, probably the, you know, the speaker would cover these areas very well. Thank you for the question. Hope I have clarified your mind.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. There is one more question by anonymous attendee. Sir, your views on the thought abnormalities in schizotypal disorder, particularly in terms of eccentricity.
Right. So basically, schizotypal disorder, you know, the typical descriptions that you get is the thought processes are very stilted, you know, stilted speech, right? Probably, again, this will be covered again in speech and language, I think. So, you know, stilted speech is something like speech which is very obsolete, or, you know, the terms used are pedantic speech or too formal speech. For example, you know, the example that is given in Sims or some textbook is an individual who wants to request to have a conversation with a lady. He goes and tells her, will you give me the opportunity to have a conference with you, right? So, you know, it looks like old British English, right? So it's very, you know, it's not trendy, like, to put it in very simple terms. The kind of English that we speak, you know, the trends that you are aware of, a person with schizotypal disorder may be deviating from that, okay? So the speech may appear very pedantic, or, you know, too formal, you know, or too odd, right? So that is what is manifested in speech of this particular individual. Another thing that is described in textbooks is something known as pseudo-philosophical thinking, right? So the speech is very, very, you know, too philosophical, too metaphorical, right? Instead of talking in concrete fashion, the individual uses a lot of metaphors, or, you know, uses a lot of philosophical ideas. So these are two characteristic things that can be seen in the thinking and the speech process, you know, in the speech of a particular individual with schizotypal disorder. Of course, there are many other problems which I will cover in disorders of content. So I will, because of lack of time, I will stop here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, sir. I would like to request the participants to post their questions in question and answer chat box. So one more question by Mano Rakesh. Sir, in the river analogy of thought, stream content are understandable, but how form and position can be described?
Okay. Do you want an analogy for them? I think, of course, possession is very clear. You know, what is possession is basically disorders of possession are disorders of volition also. Okay. So, you know, like, for example, if you think of, you know, say, for example, thought insertion, right? So we all have this feeling that our thoughts are very private. Nobody can look into my thoughts. Like, for example, I may be very nervous at the beginning of this session, but I'm very happy that none of you can make it out, you know, very well, because you can't really go into my mind and look at my thoughts. My thoughts are very private to me. I may be thinking, oh my God, how will I present today, right? But still, you will not be able to know it. So I have this sense of possession and privacy, you know, which I will probably explain in the next session again, which may not be there if I have a disorder of possession or disorder of volition. So it is very scary. You know, somebody can spy on my thoughts. You know, my thoughts are not private. Anybody can look into, you know, they can use a satellite, they can use, you know, some smartphone technology to get into my thoughts, right? But sometimes, you know, even I feel such things with Facebook and Instagram these days, you know. So on a lighter note, okay. So that may be one easy analogy that you can keep in mind to understand possession of thought. Form of thought, I don't have anything on the top of my mind, but I think it's very clear that basically form of thought is about you know, how you organize, you know, how basically all the ideas that you have, like, for example, you know, the ideas that I have about thought disorder, I try to, you know, put it in a certain, you know, organized form. If I had not put it in an organized form, it wouldn't have made much sense to all of you, right? So that organization, right? So the planning that happens, or, you know, the monitoring that we do in our thinking process, that what am I going to speak next? Am I telling it correctly? Am I conveying my idea properly? All that thing that happens, you know, basically decides the organization or the conceptual organization or form of thought. So hope I have answered your question. Maybe I'll be prepared in the next session, because I'm taking the next session too, maybe. So sure. I will answer it in a better way. Yeah.
Yes, yes. Thank you, sir. And there is one more question by Dr. Dwarika Verma. How to assess the speech of a mania patient?
Right. So I think, you know, it should not be very tough, because, of course, a patient who is in florid mania definitely has very productive speech. So there is a lot of speech output. So even if you make the person sit in front of you, he will look at your watch and make a comment. He will look at your hairstyle and make a comment. You know, a conversation will start automatically, right? And they have such an infectious affect that, you know, it's very easy to have a very, you know, a conversation with most patients with mania, unless they are irritable, of course. You know, a patient who has euphoric mania, it'll be much easier, right? And I would strongly suggest, because you have the technology, record the conversation with your patients and go back and listen to those conversations and try to discern whether there were any jumping from one topic to the other, whether there were chance associations, whether there were associations because there was something in the environment which the person saw and started speaking about it, right? So whether there were alliterations, assonance, and all the other things that you see in poetry, you know, rhyming, you know, punning, such stuff, right? So you must have enjoyed a lot talking with many patients with mania. You know, I have some experience from CIP Ranchi where a patient would go on telling shairis, you know, one after the other, right? Talk, you know, you give any topic, he will fire a shairi to you, right? So I think assessment would be very easy. And, you know, giving time, you know, of course, he will not, a patient with florid mania will not let you speak. So there is no point in, you know, there is no trouble at all assessing a person with manic thought disorder, I feel. Hope I have answered your question.
Yeah. Sir, there is one more question by anonymous attendee. Sir, what is the difference between prolixity and circumstantiality?
Right. I already addressed this in my talk. But I will just briefly tell you. See, you know, prolixity is basically ordered flight of ideas. That is, in flight of ideas, there are too many chance associations, right? Too much clanging. The person jumps from one topic to the other, which may have very remote associations. Whereas in ordered flight of ideas or prolixity, there is some amount of association. The chance associations are less. That's why the person is able to reach the goal, you know, the end point. He is able to reach the end point. Also, you know, unlike circumstantiality, which can be very boring, you know, when the person goes on giving you all the trivial details and goes into a very circuitous way, taking you into very tedious details, right? As I gave an example, you know, it starts becoming very, very boring. And many people with circumstantiality, you know, circumstantiality, which is characteristically described in epileptic personality, especially someone with decades of temporal lobe epilepsy, you know, they have such, you know, in their circumstantial speech, the speech also is very, very, you know, monotonous and boring and very rigid. You know, circumstantiality can also be seen in obsessional personality or anancastic personality, right? Or in anxiety disorders or in obsessive compulsive disorders. So circumstantial speech is very boring to listen to, whereas prolixity has lot of, you know, charm to it. It has a lively embellishment. You want to listen more and more to it, right? So that would be probably the differences between circumstantiality and prolixity.
Thank you, sir. There is one question by Kapil Bansal. Can you please explain driveling thinking once again? And there is another question by Anand Mulbagal. Desultory thinking with the example. So I think they want explanation regarding dribbling and desultory.
Yeah, yeah. So one thing I would tell you, these you know, categorizations are mostly of historical interest, as I already told you. And we don't really focus on, you know, whether this is dribbling or desultory thinking. And as I mentioned already, you know, you can look up at SAP scale by Nancy Anderson and look at the particular thought disorders that are mentioned, which are more easy, more common in our patients, right? So that's, I would start with that. And, you know, dribbling thinking, as I already told, I have a set of ideas. I already have a set of ideas that I want to present right now. You know, the question that you asked on dribbling, I have all the ideas. What is dribbling, right? But I'm unable to organize that answer in a fashion that would make sense to you, right? So as I depicted in the diagram also, the organization of the pieces of thought is not appropriate. It's all jumbled up. So there are ideas, but there is no good organization. So basically what happens is sometimes the thought does not make much sense to you at the end of it, right? So that is dribbling, right? And desultory thinking, what is described in textbooks is, you know, there is continuous flow of speech in this particular patient. Okay. So there are various ideas that are appearing, which have good association between them. And suddenly out of nowhere, there is one idea which forcibly comes in between, which is completely unrelated, which does not have any association with the original stream of thought, original sequence of thoughts. So that is desultory thinking, right? For example, I am talking about formal thought disorder. I am talking about Schneider's classification of formal thought disorder. And suddenly in between, I start talking about how depersonalization is a very, very important characteristic of schizophrenia. And then again, I continue with formal thought disorder. So this idea about depersonalization somehow forces in between. So why does that happen in a patient with schizophrenia? Is because they may have a certain set of themes in their head. For example, they are talking about their childhood because they have, you have asked them question about their childhood in your interview, but because they are so preoccupied with paranoid thoughts that some paranoid thought just forces in between the thought process that was going on. That is, he's speaking about his childhood, but in between some paranoid thought just forces, you know, in between that sequence of thoughts. That I think would be an example for desultory thinking, right? Hope it was, you know, simple enough to understand.
Yeah. And again, there are some several questions by anonymous attendee. Can you tell how to differentiate between derailment and flight of ideas? And second question, what about the confidentiality while using the technology?
Okay, all right. Oh, this is a difficult question. So derailment and flight of ideas, this is a wonderful question. I did not have the time to cover this. You will be surprised. Nancy Anderson, right in 1980s itself, has told that we should do away with the term flight of ideas, because somehow flight of ideas, it, you know, हमारे दिमाग में एक बत्ती जल जाता है, that it is mania, flight of ideas. But as she clearly tells, flight of ideas can be seen even in schizophrenia. What is flight of ideas? It's basically jumping from one topic to the other. So derailment is very, very close to flight of ideas, according to Nancy Anderson. Okay. So as I already told, derailment is, you know, more of historical interest, you know, when it comes to derailment described by Schneider, I mean. Okay. So he tells that there is a flow of thought. You expect that the flow of thought will progress like this, but it moves on to some subsidiary thought, which is not very related to the original set of thoughts. That is described as derailment, right? But, you know, if derailment happens many times during the speech, it will be like flight of ideas. And if there is a rapid speech, you can even call it as, you know, flight of ideas, which is typically described in a patient with mania, right? So this understanding in our, this tendency in our head to equate derailment to schizophrenia should be done away with, right? So that's what Nancy Anderson focuses on in her articles. You should look up her articles. You know, I don't remember the exact names. They were published mostly between 1985 to 87, I think. I have looked up those articles, you know, so you definitely have to access them and read about it. You will start thinking about these things in a more, you know, clear fashion. So I hope I have clarified what is derailment and difference between derailment and flight of ideas. Okay. When there is rapid speech and pressure of speech in derailment or flight of ideas, it is typical of mania. That's what you should remember. Okay. Right. Although for exam purposes, sometimes we have to write what are Carl Schleider's explanations about, these formal thought disorders. But for our practical purposes, they are very much the same. And another, somebody asked about the confidentiality. If your patient has got the, judgment, definitely ask him that I'm going to record it. But, it is completely for my, analysis to help you in treatment, of you. And only if the patient permits you, you can record, right? If you are really concerned about the ethical aspects of it, right? But if somebody is not willing to give you permission, maybe you can ask from the immediate caregiver who is, responsible for the management of that particular patient, right? And if they give permission, you can even document it in your file if you want, right? That I give my permission to record a speech sample so that it will be used for my own treatment, right? So I can only think of this. I have not looked up literature for this, definitely. Hopefully seniors in the group can, enlighten more on this. Thank you. Dr. Narayan, any other questions? It's 9 o'clock.
Thank you, sir. I think Narayan, sir, is my case now.
Okay.
Myself, Dr. Harish. Yes. Sir, there is one more question. Is it possible to distinguish between tangentiality and circumstantiality in the flow of speech? Or is it possible only after completion?
Right.
And same Anand also asks that the thought block and decreased reaction time, how to differentiate between them? I think we can take these questions as last questions, sir, because we are already overshot the time.
Yes, sir. I will come to thought block and increased latency. Of course, increased latency, as the name itself suggests, the individual eventually gives you an answer. Okay. But I understand your doubt that, there is a long pause. Okay. And the individual may take such a long time and appear lost that you may think that whether this person is having thought block. But what you have to remember is the subjective experience of thought block and the subjective experience of thought retardation or slowing of thinking or inhibition of thinking is very different. Okay. Whereas a person with slowing of thinking or, inhibition of thinking, he will be preoccupied with pessimistic themes. He will be preoccupied with very gloomy thoughts, which are, which is so much clouding his thoughts that he is unable to get ideas about questions that you are asking. So he's taking a long time to answer. So if you ask him, what is the subjective experience like? Why are you taking such a long time? Can you describe me? How is this? How do you feel that inside your mind? The person may tell you that, doctor, I am so preoccupied with other things, I'm unable to answer your question. Or he may say that I feel, somewhat clouded. I feel my thoughts are foggy, right? That's the kind of explanation you would get in a patient with psychomotor retardation in moderate depression or severe depression with inhibition or slowing of thinking. Whereas in a person with thought block, you may feel that the person is fearful or he is feeling very anxious, right? That, suddenly his thoughts have gone blank. So that subjective experience is one of anxiety or fear. And there may be a delusional explanation also that somebody is trying to steal my thoughts or somebody is doing some, they are conspiring something to, understand what I'm thinking, right? So the difference is very, very, apparent when thought block occurs in schizophrenia. But then you may ask thought block, sir, we have experienced thought block even in an exam when we are extremely anxious, when we are extremely exhausted, we experience thought block. What would you tell that, right? But as you can easily, understand or you have experienced, I also experienced in a viva when you don't remember the answer, the thought block that you experience is of course anxiety provoking. It makes you so anxious that why am I not getting this particular answer? So mostly you would feel very anxious when you have thought block, either in schizophrenia or in other disorders such as anxiety disorders, whereas increased latency of thought or increased latency of speech that you see in psychomotor retardation of depression the person would tell about other preoccupations would be mostly gloomy or would have a pessimistic set of thoughts. Hope I've answered this question. The yes. other thing that
thank you very much,
I think
sir.
I forgot about it.
Yeah. Okay, sir.
Maybe
difference between tangentiality and circumstantiality.
Correct. I had a thought block. Yeah. So basically, I think what we can say is circumstantial speech, as I already told, ultimately the person comes to the goal of what he began with. Whereas in tangential speech, he completely takes a tangent. As I showed a diagram, we have learned in mathematics, he completely misses the point. So whatever you have asked, you are asking him about his childhood experiences, he starts talking about his business, right? It's completely tangential to what you want him to speak. So I think another part you were asking was whether we can make it out, at the end of it. Of course, you will have to make it out at the end of it, I think. Tangential speech need not be tedious and boring like circumstantial speech, whereas circumstantial speech is very monotonous and boring mostly, right? You get annoyed at the listening to that, right? So hopefully that has answered your questions.
Yes, thank you very much, Karkada sir, because you are a opening batsman, you are like Rohit Sharma, you are still not out. Wonderful presentation, sir. So over to our secretary Dr. Bijoy sir, because we will be meeting with the same speaker and chairperson next week, also next Friday. So the topic will be disorders of possession and content of thought. Sir Bijoy sir, yeah. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Narayan. Thank you, Dr. Ravi. Actually, many times I met Ravichandra Karkar. When you directly meet him and speak, it was today's experience was quite different, in the sense he was so lively in the presentation. Your slides were fantastic and you were so lively. And usually when I met you, you were somewhat reserved when you directly
I have, maybe my social anxiety, sir.
I don't know. Many times when I met that just now me and Meshkoda sir was discussing about the same. And definitely benchmarks our faculty members who are putting Mohan as set another one benchmark, and you are also making another benchmark. And it was very especially the diagrams he used and thematic representation was made the participants to learn, understand the things in a better way. And on behalf of Indian Psychiatric Society, from President and all the Executive Committee members, I thank you, Dr. Ravichandra, for this wonderful presentation. And I thank the chairperson, today's chairperson, as well as our chairman, our president of IPSKC, Dr. Sipati Bhatt, for the chairing this session. I would like to tell you one thing, that at one given time, 150 members were the participants, and on YouTube, there were around 30 to 40, and almost we reached around 180 mark today. And definitely the speed, as Narayan has told, the opening batman is still not out. It will reach 300 plus, benchmark. And you'll set another record definitely in the next session.
I thank very good, wonderful.
Dr. Narayan Muthalik and Dr. Harish, who have made the what is the task was given by the IPSKC, they superbly completed it in the beginning. Well, the well begun will definitely, there is a saying, well begun will definitely win the game. Yeah, definitely. Thank you, Narayan and Harish. And I thank Mr. Sriram, the representative of the ICON, who is technically helped us. I thank you, the Sriram, as well as the ICON team. And my special thanks to Dr. Mahesh Goda and the team of Telearoga members, Vijay R.B. Shetter, Dr. Jagdish Aye. And I thank all our EC members. And I thank all the participants. The dear participants, there is still lot to go and lot to learn. Kindly, live streaming is there on YouTube, as well as the recordings also available on the YouTube. The links will be shared soon. You can see the links and learn again and again. So Thank you for the wonderful presentation once again to Dr. Ravi.
Thank you,
with the permission of the chair.
Final comment from you. Yes, thank you very much to Dr. Shripati Bhatt sir for chairing this session and his valuable inputs. And thank you, Dr. Narayan and Dr. Harish, for helping me out with the questions. And of course, our secretary, Dr. Somshekhar sir, and you know, the president, I'm indebtful for giving me this opening batsman role for this psychopathology series. And I wish well to this initiative. I hope it you know, kindles the minds of young psychiatrists in Karnataka and all over India. And you know, it enhances our patient care. You know, thank you so much.
Yes, definitely. Thank you, Sriram sir from Icon Life Sciences.
Thank you, Sriram. Thank you.
With the permission of the president, sir, I would like to end the session, sir.
Yes, sir. The president, sir, is not live, I think.
Okay. Yes, on behalf of president, sir, I would ask Sriram to conclude the session. Thank you, Sriram.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. We look forward to another interesting series, like how we had psychodiagnostics and psychopharmacology running with almost the same kind of audience across all the sessions. And quite interesting, like the people usually during the sessions, you know, the number keeps wavering. This time, at least till 10 minutes back, the whole audience were sticking to the group and no one logged out. So that is proof enough for us in terms of the interest that people have in learning and in this session so far. Thank you very much, sir. And good night.
Good night.
Thank you. Good night. Good night.
Good night, everybody.
Good night. Good night. Thank you.